Good afternoon, colleagues. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio question session is recovery in parliamentary business. I remind members that questions 3, 4 and 7 are grouped together, and therefore I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after all questions 3, 4 and 7 have been answered. Otherwise, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And as ever, in order to get as many people in as possible, I would urge there be short and succinct questions and answers to match. Question number one, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its policies and actions across government will support Ayrshire's recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is working to ensure Ayrshire recovers and prospers as it emerges from the pandemic. The Ayrshire Growth Deal will see the Scottish Government invest £103 million over 10 years across Ayrshire, funding projects such as the Great Harbour and Ayrshire Manufacturing Investment Corridor. Additionally, we are supporting the development of Ayrshire's Regional Economic Partnership, which will set out a regional strategic vision for the region. Ayrshire will also benefit from the national policies included in our 10-year national strategy for economic transformation, our Fair Work First approach and our infrastructure investment plan.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Scottish Government is establishing a £500 million transition fund for the north-east of Scotland. With the closure of Hunterston B in January and the loss of some 570 jobs over the next 3 years, will the Cabinet Secretary consider a transition fund for North Ayrshire as part of its COVID-19 recovery to help the transition from nuclear power to renewables?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I recognise the significance of the issue and the importance attached to it by Mr Gibson. The Hunterston site is important for North Ayrshire and the wider community. With the forthcoming decommissioning of the Hunterston B site, we want to ensure that valuable skills are not in any way lost to Ayrshire or the Scottish economy. That's why within the Ayrshire Growth Deal there's a skills fund which will support skills interventions across the region. Also included within the deal is a project cited at Hunterston which specifically addresses energy decarbonisation and will support offshore renewable energy development. The Ayrshire Regional Economic Partnership are leading work on long-term strategic economic development, and the Government will support them in that ongoing work.
Question number two, Katie Clark.
The Scottish Government what action it is taking to measure the progress of its COVID-19 recovery policies.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, we will continue to take a range of actions to measure the progress of our COVID-19 policies. This will include regular measurements around furlough levels, employment statistics and business resilience, and tracking Scotland's broader wellbeing through the National Performance Framework. I will also shortly publish the COVID recovery strategy, and alongside this we will develop a monitoring framework with partners to ensure we are making progress.
Katie Clark.
At the recent Scottish elections, all political parties spoke about a jobs-led recovery. What action is the Scottish Government taking across all departments to support the creation of jobs, in what sectors, and what can the Scottish Government do to ensure that support is in place for people who may lose their jobs in the coming months as furlough comes to an end?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think this is a very important question, and I welcome the thoughts and the contributions of Katie Clark in this respect. The Government has a number of employment-based interventions, the Transition Training Fund, for example, as one particular proposition, which is designed to address exactly the circumstances that Katie Clark puts to me in supporting individuals to be able to move from one sector to another. In relation to sectoral activity, obviously that question will vary around the country. Mr Gibson's question about the north-east of Scotland raises the issues about oil and gas transition into the bargain. But I do give the member the assurance that right at the heart of the government's employment strategy is a focus on communities that have been the hardest hit by COVID, with the greatest risk of disruption because of the end of the furlough scheme. And our interventions will be focused on supporting individuals to sustain employment in those circumstances.
Emma Harper, supplementary.
Citizens Advice Scotland research shows that across Scotland, 1.4 million people have run out of money before payday in the last year and warn that the end of furlough and cut to universal credit risks further financial insecurity. So what assessment has the Deputy First Minister made of the impact that this will have on Scotland's COVID recovery?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, I recently had a very helpful discussion with Citizens Advice Scotland explaining the wider assessment that they are making of the impact of financial hardship on our society and the dangers that changes such as the reduction in universal credit will affect. If the universal credit cuts take place, they will estimate to push 60,000 Scots into poverty and hundreds of thousands of others into hardship. I've just come from a discussion amongst my ministerial colleagues about measures the government is taking to address the issues of child poverty and to ensure that we have in place effective support to ensure that our objectives are achieved and that we protect individuals as far as we can from the negative effects of the reduction in universal credit, which will inflict hardship on many citizens in our country.
Question number three, Jamie Halkett-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government how it will monitor and review the COVID-19 vaccine certification scheme.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, as with other COVID measures, we are under a legal duty to review the necessity of the regulations every 3 weeks. We have a duty to review the necessity and proportionality of the recommendations. Policy decisions at these review points will be informed from a range of evidence from the Four Harms perspective, with which Parliament will be familiar. This review will measure the certification programme outcomes against the policy objectives of increasing vaccination uptake, the prevalence of COVID-19 within Scotland, and pressures on the National Health Service. A key factor within this review will, of course, be to ensure the policy impact remains proportionate for the business sector and society at large. Certification regulations are due to expire on the 28th of February 2022. However, we do not want to have the scheme in place any longer than is necessary. Therefore, if evidence and clinical advice indicated that certification was no longer required, we would remove it.
Jamie Halkett-Johnson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. With just over a week until the scheme is supposed to come into place, the Nighttime Industries Association is launching legal action against plans which they say is not proportionate and likely to be unlawful. Hospitality Scotland has said business confidence has been shattered. And yesterday, Liz Cameron of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce said businesses were expected to bear the burden of implementation costs without any financial support whatsoever of a scheme which they believe is not workable in the timescales being proposed. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does he think all these bodies are wrong?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I quite clearly accept that there's a difference of opinion between the government and these bodies. But I think I invite these bodies and I invite the Conservative Party to think about what the alternatives are. Because the alternative is that many of these sectors have to close because of levels of infection within the society. Now, we don't want that to be the case, so we're trying to take proportionate action to ensure that we can avoid that situation prevailing. It's the type of proportionate action that the Welsh Assembly Government has taken. It's the type of proportionate action that the United Kingdom Government is prepared to take, should it judge that to be necessary. So we are engaged in dialogue with these sectors. We've set out the basis upon which the scheme will operate. Further details will be set out in due course and will be implemented, as the First Minister confirmed yesterday, at 5 a.m. on the 1st of October.
Question number four, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what arrangements are in place for people to query their COVID-19 vaccine certification status if they believe their records are incorrect.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, any suspected errors in a person's COVID-19 vaccination record should be reported to the Vaccination Status Helpline on 0808 196 8565. The helpline can only resolve issues in relation to vaccinations administered in Scotland. We are aware that some health boards are experiencing increased requests to update vaccination records, and people can do this via the helpline. People who receive their vaccine from a GP can still register online to receive their record of vaccination if required for international travel.
Claire Adamson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. It's very helpful, and I note the First Minister's answer to similar questions yesterday. Would it be Is the Cabinet Secretary able to give any indication of when other anomalies in the system can be addressed, such as people who are working in the Middle East and oil industry and have returned having had their first vaccine out with Scotland, or indeed some of the other examples that were raised yesterday in the COVID statement? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously, we're acting to address any particular issues that individuals face on a systemic basis. A number of the points in relation to the common travel area are being resolved as we speak and have been resolved already, and we will work as expeditiously as we can to ensure that all of the potential scenarios that emerge can be properly and fully addressed.
Thank you. And before moving to the other group question, question seven, could I remind members that I'll take supplementaries on these grouped questions after the end of question seven, and if members wish to seek to have a supplementary, could they press the request to speak button? Question seven, Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the anticipated criteria for exemption from the COVID-19 vaccine certification scheme.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, we've identified the following three criteria for exemptions: under 18 years, participants in vaccine trials, and people unable to be vaccinated for medical reasons. We are working on the medical conditions which would most closely be linked with an inability for a patient to be immunised. We expect the number of people in such a position to be very small. All clinical trial participants have already received a letter from the principal investigator, which can be used for proof of their trial status.
Fulton McGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. I know he answered to my colleague Claire Adamson a minute ago, but I wonder if he could elaborate on those proposed guidelines for how those who got fully vaccinated abroad can also obtain a vaccine certificate or clearance to attend events where a certificate is required in Scotland. And in terms of where exemption is based on health grounds, does he anticipate the need for a doctor's or other medical note, or will the relevant individuals in some instances be able to self-report as needing an exemption?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, we're developing an approval process for medical exemptions, and we will publish the detail of how this will work before implementation, along with the necessary guidance. Obviously, if there are any issues that arise out of that guidance, then I would encourage people to contact the National Helpline on the number that I gave earlier. In relation to the scenario where people are vaccinated in other countries, obviously the scheme will recognise people who were vaccinated with an MHRA-approved vaccine. Before the scheme goes live, we will put in place an interim process to enable a Scottish resident who has had a dose outside Scotland to have their vaccine record updated. For visitors from the rest of the United Kingdom and the broader common travel area, we'll be able to use their existing COVID status apps with QR codes and paper-based certificates to gain entry to relevant venues in Scotland.
Supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Just to follow up on that question from Fulton McGregor, there are visitors from other parts of the United Kingdom who will be travelling to events and football matches in Scotland, but do not have apps, rather just paper proof of vaccination. Will there be guidance issued to venues and to football clubs as to what the appropriate certification needs to be for those in that category, given that it varies between different parts of the United Kingdom?
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously the guidance will be made available, and we will continue to discuss with football authorities what information would be of relevance for them to have to guide the decisions that they will have to make in implementing the certification scheme.
Supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any information on discussions around those particularly younger people who have not yet been able to receive a second dose of the vaccine due to being recently infected with COVID, and how this will affect their ability to access events and venues covered by the certification scheme, given the likelihood that they too have developed antibodies?
Cabinet Secretary.
I suspect the number of cases that will be involved in such a scenario will be relatively limited. But what I would encourage individuals to do in such circumstances is to raise their circumstances with the National Helpline, should they be unable to have been vaccinated for the circumstances that Emma Roddick has outlined. We're obviously trying to ensure that we have in place a proportionate intervention which ensures that we strengthen the safety, and minimise the risk of transmission in certain venues and boost the level of uptake into the bargain. So these are all the objectives that we're trying to achieve, and obviously we are encouraging individuals to secure the necessary vaccination and certification to enable us to achieve the policy objectives of this intervention.
And supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
I am delighted that QR codes are in place. Indeed, my constituents are. One travelled to France on the 5th of September. Unfortunately, the QR code didn't work, so she didn't have access to cafes, restaurants, museums. As you can imagine, it put quite a dampener on things. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us if there have been reports of similar problems and how they will iron out such glitches in the system quickly?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, if Jackie Bailey wishes to share with me the details of that circumstance, I will, of course, have it investigated. There will inevitably be technical challenges in any rollout of a scheme of this nature. We obviously try to minimise that. Where we identify particular problems, we work to address them as quickly as possible. So if Jackie Bailey wishes to furnish me with the details, I will certainly address that and respond to her directly and to her constituent. And I'm sorry that our constituent was unable to access facilities as a consequence.
Question number five, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how its policies and actions across government will support Mid Scotland and Fife to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, we are actively supporting economic recovery in Mid Scotland and Fife, as we are across the whole of Scotland. That includes over £150 million to support local businesses and additional funding of over £170 million for the area's four local authorities. We have committed over £495 million across three city region deals in Mid Scotland, and which will help to drive a sustainable recovery from the pandemic in the long term. That includes £25 million for an innovative investment programme in Fife that will support the growth of cutting-edge businesses that can deliver good, fair jobs for local people.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. While young people were the least likely to become ill during the pandemic, they have had a huge impact on their education, their mental health and their work. Many young people in my region are anxious about the long-term impact, and we must ensure these do not translate into further inequalities. So in the programmes that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, how are they making sure that generational impact of COVID is being addressed in the policies for recovery?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Claire Baker raises a very fair point, and part of what the economic interventions the government is taking forward is designed to create long-term sustainable economic and employment opportunities for individuals. By their nature, that involves ensuring that the interests of young people are very much at the heart of the design of those interventions. Now, by ensuring that all of the interventions that I talked about in my original answer will have relationships to higher and further education institutions within the Mid-Scotland and Fife area, with which Claire Baker will be familiar. And all of these institutions will have particular roles and responsibilities in ensuring that the needs of young people are adequately and fully represented. So I'm confident that the challenges that young people have faced in the last 18 months through COVID can be properly and fully addressed by making sure we have in place a skills and education and investment approach which meets their needs and ensures that they are able to access opportunities for the future, and that they are in no way disadvantaged by the difficult experience they have had in the course of COVID.
Question number six is from Colin Beattie, who is joining us remotely. Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the COVID Recovery Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding action to support the hospitality sector to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
Sorry, sir, I recognise the value of hospitality and tourism sectors and their importance in our recovery. I have regular dialogue with my colleagues as part of Cabinet discussions. These will be ongoing as we prepare for the 2022-23 budget. We will continue to ensure that the budget prioritises recovery, and we are aware that hospitality has been particularly hard hit. Over the past year, the Government has worked closely with sectoral organisations such as the Scottish Tourism Alliance, the UK Hospitality and Scottish Hospitality Groups on the recovery, and support for the tourism and hospitality sectors has been designed to address the issues that they have drawn to our attention.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. What support is being provided to retail and hospitality sectors who are facing the increasing issue of non-compliance regarding face coverings and physical distancing?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, over the course of the last few weeks, as the Government has worked to address the high levels of infection that we have been experiencing, we have been engaged in a series of discussions with a range of business sectors, including retail, hospitality and tourism, to encourage their involvement in the application of the baseline measures, such as the wearing of face coverings, to provide maximum resistance to the circulation of the virus. Now, in those discussions, I have to applaud the willingness of the retail, hospitality and tourism sectors to work with us. And I think some of the recent reductions in the level of caseload, which although still high, is lower than it was, is as a consequence of the response to our appeals for their support. In addition to that, there is obviously a great deal of public messaging that the government is putting out and communicating to ensure that individuals are aware of the necessity of wearing face coverings and the advantages and protections that come from it. And we will continue to share those messages with a wider audience to ensure that those baseline measures are an effective resistant to the circulation of the virus.
And question number 8, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on cross-government coordination of COVID-19 recovery policies.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the impact of COVID is such that it requires us to ensure that across our public services we have a coherent approach to the necessity of COVID-19 recovery. The member will be aware that the Justice Recovery Plan was published in March and the NHS Recovery Plan was published on the 25th of August. To ensure coordination and collaboration across the Scottish Government, a number of ministerial groups have been established to ensure that we take a collective view on the priorities for recovery. I will shortly publish the COVID recovery strategy that will set out how collectively we will ensure that actions at national and local level are prioritised, coordinated and targeted most effectively to meet the needs of people disproportionately disadvantaged by COVID-19. This work follows a number of months of open discussions involving Scotland's public, private and third sectors to allow them to shape the sort of recovery that Scotland requires.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. Some concern has been expressed over the transparency of Scottish Government spending on COVID-19 recovery. Last week, a report from the Auditor General warned that it is becoming increasingly hard to define what is and what isn't COVID-19 spending. What steps will the Cabinet Secretary take to increase the transparency of COVID-19 spending?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think there's the government publishes a vast amount of information on its public expenditure, down to very small items of public expenditure that are regularly publicly reported. So I don't actually think there is a shortage of information about public expenditure. I think where I would probably agree with Audit Scotland is that it's challenging to distinguish between what is exclusively COVID-19 recovery expenditure and what might be wider public expenditure, given the fact that COVID-19 has had a cumulative effect on the government's priorities. The question from Mr. Lockhart is predicated on there being a need for cross-government coordination of COVID recovery policies, which rather suggests that there is a cross-government impact of COVID. So we will continue to be as open and transparent as we possibly can do about public expenditure, but I think a starting point of that analysis has to be an acceptance that COVID has had an effect on all areas of public expenditure and public policy, and as a consequence it is likely that public expenditure will be similarly influenced.
Thank you, and that concludes portfolio questions on COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business. The next portfolio questions is net zero energy and transport. And again, I would remind members that if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And I start with question number one, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the aspects of the Strategic Transport Projects Review regarding the Scottish borders.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Borders Transport Corridor Study emphasised the importance of a connected, safe, resilient and high-quality strategic transport network for the Scottish borders. The study's recommendations are now being appraised within STPR2. The appraisal involves consideration of a range of criteria to determine the socio-economic benefits and overall value for money. This also takes into account factors such as affordability, deliverability, risk and uncertainty. This is an important consideration given the pressures on current and future public finances. The review is due to conclude later this year with publication of recommendations and a statutory consultation period.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In February's STPR2 and the recent programme for government, there was no mention of bringing forward a feasibility study to extend the Borders Railway. Yet, in Scottish Affairs Committee, Kate Forbes said, "We are certainly committed to pursuing the process, which will hopefully deliver the extension. The deal, of which we are signatories, includes a commitment to progress that work." So, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, when will the feasibility study begin? Who is undertaking the study? And how will the £10 million Borderlands Growth Deal funding be spent?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the member will be aware that as part of the Borderlands Growth Deal is that we have committed £5 million towards the feasibility study. The feasibility study, though, is carried out after STPR2 has been complete. That identifies the rationale and the justification for whether an extension of the Borders Railway line should be taken forward in the first place, which should then be followed by the feasibility study. That's exactly what's been proposed, and that's exactly what continues to be the case.
Thank you. I now move to question number two, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it's giving to young people in the run-up to COP26 to ensure that their views on climate change are listened to.
Cabinet Secretary.
Last week, we announced £300,000 support for the Conference of Youth, the UN's official youth event for COP26. Five young people from Scotland, for the first time, will join participants from around the world and help shape the conference's statement. We're also supporting the Young Scot-led Scottish Youth Climate Programme, which enables Scottish children and young people to host a climate youth summit ahead of COP to design the legacy they want from COP and to act as local champions across the country.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Now, we all know that our young people will live with the decisions that we make today the longest. Given this and the Climate Youth Conference that you mentioned being the platform where young people can be heard in these issues, can the Cabinet Secretary outline how ideas and suggestions put forward at said conference will be taken forward to COP26 and how Scottish outcomes based on this will be measured?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, it's extremely important that young people and the voice of children and young people is fully integrated into the approach that COP takes in coming to any consideration around tackling climate change in Glasgow. That's why we've committed to funding the COP Youth Summit, which will allow the young people who come together to set out the statement, which will then be submitted directly to COP26 to be considered by international leaders. It's absolutely critical that the voice of young people are right at the very heart of considerations around COP, and the funding of the Youth Conference for the UN is a specific example of the proactive action the Scottish Government is taking in order to ensure that children and young people's voices are heard. Our younger generation will have to deal with the consequences of our decision at COP26 and in the future. And it's essential they've put an input into designing what the outcome of COP26 will actually be.
Question number three, Megan Gallagher. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Gallagher, you haven't got your microphone on. Could you please put your card up? Thank you, Ms. Gallagher.
My apologies, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what progress it is making in meeting its target of planting 30 million trees by the end of 2021 and whether it has achieved the 22 million target last year.
And to answer, Minister Mary McCallan, who is joining us remotely. Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's woodland creation target for 2021-22 is to plant 13,500 hectares, which equates to approximately 27 million trees. Between April 2020 and March 2021, we created 10,660 hectares of new woodland, which is approximately 22 million trees.
Megan Gallagher.
The SNP Green Coalition deal was struck after the decision to honour the Greens manifesto pledge to double the number of wind farms in Scotland by 2030. In February last year, statistics released by Forestry and Land Scotland showed that 13.9 million trees have been axed to make way for 21 wind farm projects since 2000. This will not only disturb natural habitats of many endangered animals, but it could also impact climate change targets. Therefore, how many mature trees will be lost because of this manifesto pledge?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, that is a detailed and technical question, which, if you don't mind, and which, if the member is agreeable, I will take away and provide a note, a written note to answer. But can I just point out to the member that this Parliament voted for the world's most ambitious climate targets, and that we have an obligation to meet them. One of the reasons that Scotland can be so ambitious is because of the ample scope in our natural environment to sequester carbon and to support biodiversity. So the question of land use and land use change over the next 5-10 years is going to be a very pertinent one, and one which I hope we can all work together on.
Thank you. Question number four, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to improve journey times on the Dumfries to Glasgow and Stranraer to Ayr railway services to help reduce emissions from the use of other modes of transport.
Minister Graeme Day.
Presiding Officer, 75% of all passenger services are currently undertaken by zero-emission trains, with the remainder to be decarbonised by 2035. This will potentially provide journey time savings through the use of more efficient, cleaner trains across south-west Scotland. Options to replace Class 156 diesels, which currently run on the Dumfries-Galloway and Stranraer Ayr routes, are being considered. These options include self-powered fleets with battery or hydrogen fuel cells.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Minister for that answer. There are only 4 trains per day on the single-track Stranraer line, which takes 2 hours and 20 minutes to get to Glasgow, compared to just 2 hours by car. And on the Dumfries line, it takes 1 hour and 59 minutes to get to Glasgow by train, but only 1.5 hours by car. Given the climate emergency and the need to reduce journeys by car, can the Minister outline if there is a potential to increase the frequency of the trains on these lines, and outline when these currently diesel lines will be decarbonised, which will improve journey times?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the proposed May 2022 timetable seeks to improve services in the southwest of Scotland by increasing the number of services and capacity when compared to the present day timetable. It is proposed there will be an additional 6 Ayr Stranraer services compared to the current timetable, and services from Glasgow to Dumfries and beyond will increase by 5. Overall, there will be an additional 1,000 seats on a daily basis across the South West Service Group to help encourage modal shift. A study is also underway to examine potential line speed improvements and use of faster rolling stock that may become available as a consequence of changes elsewhere on the network. This will be subject to the usual affordability constraints.
A supplementary from Finlay Carson.
I'm pleased that Emma Harper has asked the Government about its commitment to improve journey times and reduce emissions, because right now the proposals on the table would appear to be slashing rail services in the south of Scotland, and the Government have got the powers to halt these. Is the Minister not aware that these are double standards, and it makes a total mockery of its commitment towards tackling climate change and just another attack on rural areas? And will he confirm that rail services will indeed increase over the next few years?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, in his haste to jump up and ask a supplementary question, clearly Mr Carson wasn't listening, so I will repeat what I said. It's proposed there will be an additional 6 Ayr to Stranraer services compared to the current timetable, and services from Glasgow to Dumfries and beyond will increase by 5, and there will be an additional 1,000 seats on a daily basis across South West Service Group to help encourage modal shift. And I'm sure, having listened to this, Mr Carson will welcome the news.
Question five was not lodged. I move on to question number 6, Fiona Hislop.
To ask the Scottish Government how commitments in the programme for government will help secure a net zero nation.
Cabinet Secretary.
This programme for government will deliver lasting action to end Scotland's contribution to climate change, restoring our nature and enhancing climate resilience, crucially in a just and fair way. Specifically, the measures on a green transport revolution and how we heat our homes will accelerate action to reduce significant emissions. Concurrently, our comprehensive and cross-governmental response to the previous Just Transition Commission sets out our ambitious agenda and first steps on delivering a just transition for Scotland, including a skills guarantee for workers in carbon-intensive sectors and the development of the Energy Just Transition plans.
Fiona Hislop.
It's clear that retrofitting of housing and business will be key in meeting targets for net zero. So can the Cabinet Secretary set out what plans there are in the coming year to embark on this massive challenge? And can he provide assurance that an independent advice service will be easily accessible to homeowners and small businesses?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signing Officer, we are taking a number of steps in this area, some of which we touched upon in the debate just yesterday. That includes investing over the course of the next 5 years some £1.8 billion to help to support and accelerate the deployment of heat and energy efficiency measures in homes and buildings across the country. Alongside that, given the nature of and the scale of this transition, we are establishing a National Public Energy Agency in order to help to educate the public on the changes required to bring new coordination and leadership to harness the potential of the programme of decarbonisation, which will be necessary across domestic and non-domestic premises over the course of the next 20 years. I can also assure the member that households and small businesses will continue to have access to comprehensive, bespoke and independent advice via Home Energy Scotland and the Energy Efficiency Business Support Service to support the transition.
And a supplementary from Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The programme for government commits to securing between 8 and 12 gigawatts of installed onshore wind by 2030 to help net zero targets. Now, between 2013 and 2020, SNP ministers directly ruled in favour of 62 onshore wind farms, despite receiving 21,500 representations. So will the SNP review the planning system for onshore wind farms to ensure local councils are properly resourced to deal with such applications and ensure the SNP respect the wishes of local people?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, the member will, I'm sure, recognise what is always the competing interest between the need to make sure that we take forward measures that can tackle climate change while also competing against the needs of local communities, which is always one of the balances in any planning process. The member will be, I'd imagine, is aware that we are presently reviewing our national planning framework, which will take into account some of the issues which have been raised around planning over recent years and also how that can remain compatible with achieving net zero. So I can assure the member that we will try to always balance these things out in an appropriate way, while at the same time making sure we meet the statutory targets that all parties in this Parliament supported in order to become a net zero country by 2045.
Question number 7, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will support Scotland's move to a circular economy.
Minister Lorna Slater.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The programme for government outlines our commitment to introducing a circular economy bill this parliamentary session. It will put in place legislative measures to support and encourage reduction of consumption, reuse, repair and recycling so as to reduce waste. There are significant economic opportunities in building a circular economy, including job creation, steps towards a well-being economy, as well as reduction in litter on our beaches and streets. We continue to support businesses to reduce waste and increase recycling, reuse and repair through Zero Waste Scotland. And we have launched a £70 million fund in this March for local authorities to use to improve their recycling systems. We are working on introducing extended producer responsibility schemes, including our deposit return scheme for single-use drinks containers, and major reforms to existing UK-wide packaging schemes to reduce waste and litter and increase recycling.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Easy question. Can the Minister confirm that the deposit return scheme will be fully operational and launched as promised on 1st of July 2022? Yes or no?
Minister.
We recognise the significant impact that COVID-19 and the EU exit has had on the drinks industry and other sectors with responsibility for delivering the Scotland's deposit return scheme. We remain fully committed to implementing the UK's first ever deposit return scheme. We want to ensure that we have a go-live date that is both ambitious and deliverable. Industry has made a positive start on the delivery, including the establishment of a scheme administrator, Circularity Scotland. But COVID-19 and the EU exit have had a significant impact on the businesses that would make the scheme a success.
Excuse me, sorry, Minister, could you resume your seat for a second? I really don't want all this sedentary harping, please. Please listen to the Minister's answer. Thank you. Minister.
In light of these challenges and in line with our commitment to continue monitoring the impact of the pandemic, we commissioned an independent review of the impact of COVID-19 on the go-live date of the scheme. We have also been considering wider feedback from stakeholders like small businesses. We will update Parliament on businesses shortly. Our ambitious deposit return scheme will play an important part in helping cut emissions, increase recycling rates, reduce littering, and build a more circular economy in Scotland.
Supplementary from Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree that there should be a moratorium on new large-scale incinerators? And will she commend the Dovesdale Action Group in South Lanarkshire for its commitment to reducing waste and building a circular economy?
Minister.
I would commend anyone who's working to reduce waste and build a circular economy. That is what we're all here to work together to do. And I'm glad to see support on this matter from across the chamber. With regard to the incineration, we will update Parliament on our plans for the review of incineration before the end of September. I know that a number of stakeholders have raised the need to have a short review period, and we are considering this carefully. Responsibility for dealing with planning applications and local planning matters rests, in the first instance, with the relevant planning authority. As a matter of law, all planning applications must be determined in accordance with the development plan for the area, unless material considerations indicate otherwise. You will appreciate that the Scottish Ministers are not able to offer comment or judgment on specific live cases.
Question number 8, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to refer members to my register of interest, which shows I'm still a member of Aberdeen City Council. And to ask the Scottish Government whether it remains supportive of Opportunity North East's ambition of establishing an energy transition zone adjacent to the new Aberdeen South Harbour.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government remains supportive of Opportunity North East's ambitions for establishing an energy transition zone and have committed some £26 million of funding to support this development. Site selection for the energy transition zone is primarily a matter for local partners and the planning authority, in this case Aberdeen City Council.
Douglas Lumsden.
I would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and it's now clear that when it comes to energy transition and net zero, the SNP are the junior partners in this coalition of chaos. Support for the oil and gas business has gone, support for the A96 Julin's gone, and no firm support for the energy transition zone plans. With this coalition, we can see the tail is certainly wagging the dog. When will the Cabinet Secretary start standing up to the Greens and protect jobs in the North East?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Presiding Officer, let's deal with the facts rather than the empty rhetoric from the member. So, £62 million into the energy transition zone within the northeast of Scotland to help to support the skills base. It will be critical to supporting the transition to zero carbon emission technology going forward, a commitment that's driving forward changes within industry, and I know is welcomed by those within the northeast that are committed to the transition. And alongside that, £500 million will be invested in the North East and Moray in the years ahead to support the transition. I hope the member will find it in his heart, his ability to welcome that £500 million, and will be big enough to stand up to his partners in London and say, match the ambition of the Scottish Government, match it by providing £500 million in the way in which the Scottish Government is doing, demonstrating this government's commitment to the northeast of Scotland and a just transition.
Thank you, and that concludes portfolio questions. And before moving on to the next item of business, which is follow-on business, can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus?